UFO was Gerry Anderson's first fully live-action television series. After more than a decade spent producing shows with puppets, the series entered production in 1969, but was set in the then future of 1980, as aliens from a distant planet began harvesting human organs for use in transplant surgery to keep their own failing bodies alive. Shadow, a top-secret international organization with their headquarters beneath a film studio in England, is established to combat the alien threat. But will even the best of the best be enough to deter the continual visits from the aliens? The first signs of an incoming UFO are usually picked up by the orbiting supersatellite SID.
This is Space Intruder Detector.
Shadow's moon base will then scramble interceptors to destroy the intruder. And once all three of them have missed the target, the next line of defense is often Skydiver 1, one of a fleet of Skydiver submarines on permanent standby around the world. As the UFO enters the atmosphere, Sky 1 is launched to seek and destroy it. But should the UFO still somehow make a landing on Earth, conveniently usually not too far from Shadow headquarters, then it's up to Shadow ground forces to close in with the mobiles. But sometimes the aliens can still sneak through undetected, and Shadow will need to keep their wits about them as they face threats the likes of which they cannot imagine.
Now don't panic, Alec.
Despite all these star vehicles, which allowed for stories set on land, in space, or under the sea, the show also included a wide cast of regular and recurring characters, with Ed Bishop's driven and determined Commander Straker proving to be one of the greatest character studies ever seen in any Gerry Anderson series. Despite often seeming cold and calculating, audiences soon got to see the vulnerable and flawed human being he really was. And several episodes focused on the personal cost Straker had had to pay in order to keep the Shadow organization functioning.
Look, it's pretty quiet here. There's nothing you can do. Why don't you go home?
What home?
In addition to fleshing out the personal lives of Straker and many of the show's guest characters, the series also allowed the organ-harvesting aliens themselves to be presented as tragic figures on more than one occasion.
Our planet is dying. Our national resources are exhausted. We must come to Earth to survive!
UFO also wasn't afraid to touch on issues like sexism and racism, even if some of its efforts must have seemed hopelessly naive even at the time.
Racial prejudice burned itself out 5 years ago.
Particularly when the show sometimes undermined its own message by placing women in positions of authority and then having the men around them act like rejects from a Carry-On film.
I think your equipment is fabulous, but I am familiar with it.
And no, we don't know what the purple wigs are about either. Following the completion of the first 17 episodes, UFO took a break in production with the closure of MGM Borehamwood, the studio where this series was being made. 9 months later, production resumed at Pinewood Studios, but since they weren't under contract, many of the cast had moved on to other work and were thus unavailable to return to the series. This led to the sudden and unexplained disappearance of many of the show's regular characters. But since the episodes were shown in a largely random order anyway, this wasn't as distracting as it might otherwise have been. Wanda Ventham returned from the first episode to fill the void left by the departure of George Sewell, and other returning cast members would fill vacant slots as needed. For its final 9 episodes, UFO became a noticeably slicker and faster-paced production than it had previously been, with Commander Straker usually finding himself at the very center of the action and pushed beyond breaking point on more than one occasion. Most of the padding that had slowed down the earliest episodes was gone, and even the original concept of the aliens themselves was refined still further, with the chilling prospect that they may need more than just human body parts to survive.
They may have no physical being at all, and therefore need a vehicle, a container, our bodies.
Although some schedulers had trouble working out exactly which age group the series was aimed at, The hardware suggested a family audience, similar to those of Anderson's previous series, but the sexual and violent elements of the show's stories were clearly unsuitable for children. UFO won a strong fan following and proved successful in the ratings, particularly in the all-important American markets of New York and Los Angeles. A second season was quickly commissioned, and work was already well underway when a sudden drop in UFO's ratings led to the premature cancellation of UFO 2.
Everything was going to be better, and we were poised for that, and to not be able to realize it was a deep, deep disappointment. It took me a long time to get over that.
Despite this major setback, Anderson still felt that the work that had already been done on the second season could be salvaged by reworking the UFO 2 concept into an entirely new series. But that's another story.
Here we go again.
Almost 50 years after it first aired, the 26 episodes of UFO continue to enjoy repeat screenings around the world, and the show has recently gained a new lease of life in high definition. It is a series that continues to enthrall new audiences by defying their expectations. The show's bright visual style and jazzy opening titles are completely at odds with the tone of the stories it tells, and its main characters are often forced to become as ruthless as the desperate enemies they're fighting in order to protect the planet. Rumors of a revival have continued to persist for many years, with some critics now viewing the series as a British precursor to such shows as The X-Files and Fringe, which only proves once again how Anderson and his team were frequently ahead of their time with their ideas.
Is this the end or the beginning?
Whether or not we ever see a new 21st century incarnation of UFO, it looks like Earth of the 1980s will always be protected by Commander Straker and Shadow.
Red alert. Confirming UFO.
Interceptors, immediate launch.
Who are they?
Why do you attack us?
Where do they come from?
We're fighting for existence.
Why do they come?
You must understand.
Although the first confirmed UFO landing on Earth occurred in 1970, it wouldn't be until 1980 that one of its alien occupants would actually be captured and examined.
We've waited a long time for this one.
With the founding of Shadow, Supreme Headquarters Alien Defense Organization, the Earth finally had an agency capable of combating these visitors from another world, whose visits usually resulted in mutilated bodies turning up near their landing sites, plus multiple outright disappearances.
A long finger of tragic coincidence, stretching across a billion miles of space.
The aliens seen in UFO are never referred to by a proper name, and the exact location of their homeworld is never established in the television series, but their civilization appears to be many centuries in advance of humanity. Humanoid in appearance, these aliens are always seen wearing a red spacesuit with a silver helmet, and are often armed with machine guns. Their helmets are filled with a survival liquid which leaves a greenish-blue tint to their skin when removed.
The interesting thing here is that the hair hasn't picked up this tint, which suggests that the liquid contains a bioacrophilic compound. Also, the fact that the eyes were protected by plastic shells seems to support this theory.
Although the aliens rely on this liquid to keep them alive during extended years in space, their own lungs can take over normal respiration should the helmet be removed or damaged. The aliens have apparently found a way to arrest the natural aging process through the use of drugs, although exposure to Earth's atmosphere usually results in them rapidly deteriorating to their true age. This was the case with the very first alien Shadow were able to examine in the show's opening episode, Identified, and an autopsy revealed he had received organ transplants from several compatible human donors.
Heart, liver, left lung, thyroid.
Providing a grim reason at last for all those mutilated bodies and disappearances. Additionally, evidence suggested that the drugs taken to prevent aging had also induced sterility, leaving the aliens as a race facing extinction and looking towards the population of Earth.
Driven on by the greatest force in the universe, survival.
Examinations of further alien bodies only reinforced these initial discoveries, but following an attack on Moonbase in the episode The Cat with 10 Lives, Shadow were forced to re-evaluate everything they had learned about the aliens so far.
It could shatter all our past theories.
Upon examining the body of an alien killed in the attack, Dr. Doug Jackson came to the conclusion that this particular individual was entirely human, albeit with his brain altered to remove sections that controlled emotion and creativity.
Only the analytical, the logical remained.
With the mind apparently wiped clean too, replaced with that of an alien, the prospect was raised that perhaps the aliens were not humanoid at all, but instead some kind of disembodied intelligence capable of taking complete possession of humanoid, or in that episode even animal, bodies.
They may have no physical being at all, and therefore need a vehicle, a container, our bodies.
The aliens are also capable of controlling human beings in less drastic ways, although the degree of this control can vary.
It's some sort of electronic probe. It had been inserted into his temple.
In Kill Straker, both Colonel Paul Foster and Captain Frank Craig were conditioned to destroy their commanding officer. Which initially manifested itself as barely disguised contempt before developing into active attempts to murder him.
Brainwashed. By who or whatever was in that UFO.
Captain Craig Collins later received similar conditioning in The Man Who Came Back, although this appeared to involve burning out the personality centers of Collins' mind and altering his brain so that he could be controlled by radio waves.
I mean, you can't reason with a robot.
Other controlled humans could appear completely normal until activated to carry out their orders, such as Naval Secretary Sarah Bosanquet in Destruction, or the three psychobombs in the episode of the same name. Perhaps most interesting was the case of John Croxley, through whose extrasensory perception the aliens appeared to speak directly to Straker and Freeman in the episode ESP.
Our planet is dying. Our national resources are exhausted. We must come to Earth. We must come to Earth to survive!
Despite this apparent plea for understanding, if not direct assistance, the UFOs continue to head towards Earth on a regular basis, and they usually tend to land in the south of England, coincidentally not too far away from Shadow headquarters.
Ask the aliens around for drinks.
These incursions range from a single craft to groups of two or three, and even occasionally several dozen.
Here we go again. Red alert! Red alert! Interceptors, immediate launch!
But thankfully, Shadow has been able to destroy the majority of them, although sometimes one slips through.
Well, the UFO has been in the Earth's atmosphere nearly 48 hours. Must move soon before it starts to disintegrate.
Very little is known also of the spacecraft the aliens use to travel to and from Earth, since those too are prone to deteriorating on exposure to Earth's atmosphere. However, by staying underwater, these spacecraft are able to avoid this deterioration indefinitely, and are sometimes only discovered after attacking shipping that has strayed too close for comfort. Most notably, a UFO was once converted into an underwater dome near an uninhabited volcanic island in the Atlantic and used as a training center for replicas of Shadow HQ personnel.
I plan to take over Shadow Control and use it to let those UFOs through.
Whether these replicas were aliens or conditioned humans who had undergone plastic surgery was unclear, as they were all destroyed when the dome was blown up. Most alien spacecraft encountered by Shadow appear to be of the same model, with each having its own escape pod and a very powerful beam weapon. They can travel many times the speed of light.
Speed 1.5 million miles per second.
With the highest recorded speed being Sol 12, 12 times the speed of light. But they generally stick to sublight speeds within Earth's solar system. Several variations have been noticed over the years, including a UFO with a transmitter on top and more than one kind of underwater craft. Other alien equipment included a powerful jamming device seen in the episode The Dalatec Affair, a cryogenic capsule designed to hold a captured human body in the Sound of Silence, and even a mysterious rock capable of inducing hallucinations in Mindbender.
Cut! And print that.
In Time Lash, we see that the aliens have even developed some kind of ability to isolate a moment of time and can impart the ability to control that moment to a human collaborator.
The nearer they come, the more power they transmit to me. I can play time like a trumpet now.
Surprisingly, for a race that appears so dependent on humanity for their own survival, the aliens have on more than one occasion hatched plans that would have devastated, if not utterly exterminated, the human population of Earth had they succeeded.
There's enough gas on that ship to destroy every form of life known on this Earth.
Upon discovering that a British naval vessel had been assigned the task of dumping a nerve agent into an ocean trench, where it could be left to dissolve harmlessly, the aliens sent a UFO to destroy the ship. They also planted two explosive devices on Earth in 1970, one of which caused an earthquake which killed 80,000 people when it was detonated in Turkey, with the other thankfully being discovered and removed to space before it could do similar damage in England. Were these plans of global catastrophe intended to deal the human race a blow great enough to finally allow a mass invasion fleet to occupy the planet and harvest survivors?
You tell me.
It certainly points to dissension among the ranks of the aliens, but occasionally, this manifests itself in positive ways too. In the episode A Question of Priorities, one UFO is seen firing on another, which then crashes into the sea off the coast of Ireland. Escaping before the crash and seeking shelter in a nearby cottage, this alien then attempts to directly contact Shadow, but is killed by the occupants of the second UFO before he can pass on any information that might aid them in their fight.
You might have told us everything.
Efforts are always continuing to learn more about the nature and origins of the aliens, as seen in the episode Close Up when a modified B-142 space probe followed a UFO back to its home planet.
We've got the answers, Alec. We've got the answers.
Although the data gathered by the probe was later declared useless following a fault with the onboard camera, we the viewers got an all too brief glimpse of a world every bit as barren and dead as the previous close encounters with the aliens had led us to expect.
A mass attack is on the cards.
It's going to come. I want to be ready.
Clearly, Shadow have a long road ahead of them, as each discovery they make seems to raise more questions than answers, and there can be no doubt that the aliens will make even more dangerous and unpredictable moves against the human race before they ever accept defeat.
Surrender. Surrender, Shadow.
You know that we can never do that.
We may never know how this conflict is ultimately resolved, but Shadow are resolute and determined in their ongoing efforts to protect the Earth.
They may be years ahead of the human race, but we've got one thing they haven't. Bloody-mindedness. It built this planet.
It was a hot summer's afternoon. And a neighbor, my next-door neighbor, knocked on my door. And he said, Ed, he said, I've just had a truckload of bricks delivered to my house. I want to know if you could come over and give me a hand unloading these bricks. I said, sure, you know, absolutely, just what I was waiting for. And I went out there, was sweating to death, unloading all these bricks. And I've been in there for about an hour. We haven't made any dent on the truck. My wife, my then wife, called me out and said, you want it on the telephone? Whew, boy, was I glad. And I galloped over there, and it was Gerry. And he said, could I get out to Pinewood right away? I said, boy, can I go? I don't go anywhere to get away from those bricks. So I ran out to these guys and said, hey, man, I got to go. And so I had a quick shower, got in the car, and zapped over there. And that's when he told me about it. Maybe he had a little sense of the dramatic. Get over to Pinewood right away.
Gerry and Sylvia Anderson, along with a familiar crew of directors and departments from the Super Mario Nation days, found themselves in new territory, and some adjusted to the changes better than others.
I think I was aware of this, but it wasn't apparent in any kind of deficiency on his part at all. You know, I mean, he was a very efficient and a very generous producer.
Maybe I walked around with blinkers on my eyes, but a couple of the directors, Dave Lane or Ken Turner or Alan Perry, one of the boys said he turned up on the first day. They had all come from the puppets, right? Gerry, being loyal, brought these guys with him. And one of them was physically ill.
I had a nice little spot on the way to work that I would get out of the car, be sick and carry on, and just hope that a bus would hit you on the way.
And he's in charge. You got to call action and cut, and we'll do it this way, that way. It's a heck of a responsibility. But no, I never sensed that.
I was ill, virtually sick every day. But I think, you know, I think most directors go on the stage with a slight bravado. You know, you have an enormous amount of pressure on you to get through the day. And I don't know any directors who really go on the stage with a sort of couldn't care less attitude. They have to go on there with a real determination to get through the day and get through the amount of work that you have to. You know, we were into, I don't know what our target was, but I think it was something like 6 minutes a day. So you just had to get through it best way you could. And we had very good artists like Ed Bishop. They're very forgiving to new directors. So it worked out pretty well for us.
Because Gerry shot the pilot, the very first episode, I think, to prove that it could be done in 10 days. And boy, if he was nervous, I didn't see it. He was very cool, calm, and collected. What he was going through inside, I don't know. I wasn't a confidant of him. But we saw the rushes afterward, and they were very professional about it. So he was there. He would consult with her which take was the best and all the rest. But we actors were very nervous. Maybe our own nerves conquered everything else. We were unaware of anybody else's nerves but our own, you know. Well, I must tell you that the original concept of the character was he was to be sitting in the office. He was a hard-ass guy who drove other people, you know, who goosed the plot along, if you like, you know, because you always had to cut to the boardroom and have a guy pointing at the porter. Now they're over here. We got to get over there. We get these guys over here. Cut to the guys doing it. And I think that was the original concept of it. But I think maybe like Frankenstein, this Straker took off, and the writers and people liked the character and its potential, and he got more out into the field and got involved more on hands-on thing. But the original concept was that he was to be the hard ass of the office. I started to dye my hair, and in those days they didn't have unisex beauty salon, so I had to go to a woman's beauty salon in Mayfair in London and sit there under the hairdryer with a whole room full of women, and that was an MGM production. That was really bad news. And also I was worried about the bleaching, constant bleaching and all the stuff they had to do, and then every 10 days it would grow out and they'd have to bleach it again. So I asked if I could possibly have a wig, and I made two or three brilliant wigs.
So whilst poor old Ed was dealing with hair dye and wigs, Gabrielle Drake, on the other hand, was struggling with the early morning starts. I can't say I blame her.
I always remember the day, a hideous day, because I used to find it almost impossible to get up at 5 o'clock in the morning. And I never used to go to sleep. I could not sleep for worry. And eventually this caught up with me and I overslept. It was nothing to do with being out late, but I overslept. And I woke up at 8 o'clock in the morning and I realised I should have been on set dressed. I panicked. I thought, what should I do? Should I actually go and catch a plane and fly away and never come back again? But I didn't. I plucked up my courage. I got into my car and I drove to Pinewood and I arrived in a terrible state, you know, long faces all around. Gerry had a long face. But then he was absolutely charming and he laughed and he sent me a very funny card. And he was so sweet and generous about it. I think he realised that it wasn't deliberate. I was in such a state.
Director Ken Turner, promoted from directing Super Marionation Puppets, also experienced some challenges working on the show.
I went off at a tangent sometimes on the scripts if I wasn't happy on the scripts, and it wasn't always to Gerry or Sylvia's liking, and so they'd, as soon as I'd finished the shoot, they'd haul me into the office and fire me. But when they started putting the thing together, they might see a little bit more into it then, and they'd decide to bring you back because there was a little bit more to the film than they first thought. So that was quite nice to be able to, first and foremost, be fired for wanting to do something that you felt was right, and secondly, it was equally nice to be asked back. So, and of course, Gerry was not too proud enough to do that, or not too proud to do that.
UFO enjoyed exposure all over the world, and for the cast, this meant a mixed bag of recognition, particularly for Ed Bishop.
I went in, I had an operation on my eye, and I had a black patch over one eye, and I had a fedora, and I had a trench coat with the collar up, and I was driving, I pulled in to get some gas, and I was signing the credit slip, and the guy said to me, he says, "You're that guy Ed Bishop, aren't you, from UFO?" And I said, "Jesus, you got to win the prize, pal." You know, and there are other people who you want to be recognized. You know, you meet a director for a job and say, "Well, I was in UFO." So, "Oh, well, what did you do in that?" I said, "For Christ's sake, you know, where have you been?" And then another time, I'm standing in Wardour Street, no wig or nothing, and a guy comes out, and a guy walks by. I'm standing there in the doorway. A well-dressed guy, attaché case. He stops, he looks at me, he says, "Hey," he says, "you're Ed Bishop." I say, "Yes, I know." He says, "You were in that UFO thing." I say, "Yes." And, it, you know, so there's no common denominator about that. But guys like Tom Baker, Shatner, and those guys who had massive exposure, I can't see how they can walk down the street. They must go around in burlap bags.
The concept of UFO was an alien infiltration of Earth to harvest human organs in order to survive, a concept which Ed thought could be greatly expanded.
I think that the concept, when it was started off, was too narrow. We had these guys coming from somewhere to take out body parts, and we lost that kind of, it was too narrow. You had to, if you listen to Star Trek, the beginning, the guy says the mission is to, a 15-year mission to explore the universe and unknown worlds. Wow. You could write anything there, but our formula was too telescoped down the wrong way. It was too narrow that we had to keep chipping away to make it a wider compass, a wider vision. So why they came was body parts and missing people. I think that was a bit of a mistake. In the end, quite by accident, I don't think by design, that we never really knew from what galaxy they came from, and that was a little bit shrouded mystery. And I think that mystery added was an asset. But in the beginning, it was too narrow, and then when they didn't explain who they were and whatever, it became an asset.
Whilst the show featured many action-packed set pieces, special effects sequences, and high-level episodes around the alien invasion, the show also tackled the human stories, particularly with Commander Straker's character. Perhaps one of the most discussed episodes of the series is a question of priorities.
"Hello, I'm inquiring about a patient, a young boy, John Straker." "Well, there must be. John Rutland. Yes, he could be under that name."
This slightly controversial episode really brings into focus just how far Straker's duty to Shadow has to go, what he has to sacrifice, and perhaps why he is the way he is, the cold and calculating commander we've come to know and love. Ed Bishop, on the other hand, may not agree.
And I had reservations about that at the time and subsequently more, because I felt that that was out of the, again, it was pressing on the series. When you stop, what do you think the point of departure was? Here they come to get body parts, and now we're concentrating on the personal tragedy of somebody in the crew. It's quite a leap, and I think you invited the audience to take too great a leap.
"Be more important than your own son's life."
"Listen, Mary, please, it's not like that.
the people who are going to watch for the soap opera elements of it, the real life interrelationships between whether this guy loves this girl who works in shadow. That's a whole other ball game. But you can't, it seems to me, to marry those two things together, you're asking for trouble. Then expecting a guy to say, gee, it was, my kid has been injured, I've got a divorce, and now I've got to save the world from alien invasion. It just strained credulity a bit too much at that point. So those episodes are concerned, that although it was great as an actor, because that's what we do, we don't want to look at monitors and say trajectory termination. We'd much rather say I love you or I don't love you. I want to be free. I mean, that's what acting's are all about. But I think it might have been a mistake.
Well, I would say the proof of the pudding is in the eating. The fact that it is still popular, still being shown, what is it, 30 years after? It seems to me that it can hardly have been a mistake. Would hardly have retained its popularity in the face of many, many other science fiction series that have arrived since then. Everything that I hear from people, I mean, they are admittedly fans, so they're bound to be in favour of it, but they seem to think that it's worn very well. And it certainly stayed the course when a lot of others have fallen by the wayside.
You're forgetting one thing, Foster. Willpower.
I think the overall, looking at them now, especially the ones that were shot at 35 mil and at MGM, I mean, the quality, definition, the integrity is fantastic. It really is. I mean, the technical aspects of it, the scene, the costumes, the presentation. And I feel that the software let the team down. The actors, to be specific. I think that, and the stories too, the writing was a little predictable. And watching it, even then, the audience was there before the characters on the screen. And that's a death knell. Because once the audience gets ahead of the characters, and the characters are still trying to figure it out, the audience has already done that, you might, your history, you're in trouble. And I think that happened to a lot of the episodes, particularly the MGM ones. But when we got to Pinewood and shot the 8 or 9 episodes we did then, it was a different ball game. And we just didn't have enough to spike the whole series of 26 with that new thought.
In September 1970 at Pinewood Studios in England, production began on the final episode of Gerry and Sylvia Anderson's first fully live-action television series, UFO.
When are you coming again?
Tomorrow.
Around the same time, the series was also receiving its television premiere.
Somewhere in an area of 50,000 square miles in northern Canada.
First in Canada on September 14th, and then in the UK from the 16th. But for the Century 21 Productions team, the end of filming on The Long Sleep marked the end of the road. Not only for the series, but for the company as a whole.
Thunderbirds are go!
Just a few years earlier, the Century 21 studio complex had been producing such critical and commercial successes as Thunderbirds and Captain Scarlet and the Mysterons. Science fiction adventure stories for the whole family that combined state-of-the-art Super Marionation puppetry with spectacular model effect sequences. But following the cancellation of the Secret Service and the disbanding of the puppet department, only the effects team remained, and now even they were surplus to requirements.
It means shutdown.
What?
With the end of UFO, and no further work on the immediate horizon, the Century 21 studios were finally closed and their buildings soon acquired by other companies.
Income tax, probably.
With their own Century 21 contracts expiring, but still ever hopeful of further work from Lou Grade and ITC, Gerry and Sylvia, along with producer Reg Hill, decided to form a new production company, Group 3 Productions.
I like it. I like it.
Group 3 received their first television commission early in 1971. When Grade approached them with an order for a 26-episode live-action detective series, The Protectors, starring Robert Vaughn and Nyree Dawn Porter. The series began filming in June, and a second season of 26 more episodes would see production run until early 1973. Yet not only was UFO about to rise from the ashes, it was also about to take on another form entirely. During their association with Lou Grade and ITC, Gerry and Sylvia Anderson's shows followed a regular pattern of production.
Action!
Most ran for only one season, and then it was on to the next.
Oh dear, how tiresome.
Despite incredible success in their country of origin and many other international markets, the Anderson shows were always produced with American audiences very much in mind, with the main prize being a sale to a major American network.
Right. Let's go!
Only Fireball XL5, sold to NBC in 1963, would ever achieve this success, with the others still airing around the USA in syndication.
What's that, Professor?
A process by which local stations affiliated with a particular major network would air programming outside of that network's primetime schedule.
I didn't mention that, Lieutenant, because, well, it's the obvious explanation.
Although profitable, a series airing in syndication would only earn ITC and Century 21 Productions a fraction of the money that a network sale could. So it's understandable that many of their shows only ran for one season. Why continue making more episodes of a show that the American networks have already passed on, when a new show could potentially be a smash hit that all the networks will want?
There's a logic to it somewhere, John.
In the case of UFO, however, it was a different story. Well, almost.
Just exactly what is that supposed to mean?
Sold to 136 local American stations in 1972, many of them CBS affiliates, UFO did particularly well on both WCBS-TV in New York and KNXT in Los Angeles.
Good, that's what I like to hear.
The reason for this was not so much to do with the show itself, but more its position in the schedule. UFO aired at 7 p.m. on Saturday evenings and was followed at 8 by the top-rated American network show of the 1972-73 season, the sitcom All in the Family, which pulled in an average of 30 million viewers every week. Many of those viewers would tune in early in order to catch UFO in syndication, with the result being that the series was frequently the most watched show of its time slot by a substantial margin.
Everything has to be their way.
By now, Gerry Anderson himself was too busy with production on The Protectors to keep a close eye on how well UFO was performing stateside, and so was surprised to discover upon returning to London from Protectors filming in Salzburg that a series which had not been a part of his life for 2 years was now apparently something of a hit in a key market.
You fell with me off.
With its American ratings showing no signs of dropping, it was decided that a second season of UFO would be produced, with the working title of UFO 2.
We've got ourselves a deal.
Entering pre-production in late 1972, the proposed second season of UFO would see the action move from the early 1980s into the 1990s, and to a vastly expanded Shadow Moon base.
4 new fully automated moon bases over the next 10 years.
Believing that the show's most successful episodes were those set in space, the second season was to see the war with the aliens escalate to the extent that very few UFOs were now able to get past moon bases' formidable defenses.
At least they won't try that again.
We started to build everything for the new show, which included a very new and very much bigger moon base and improved uniforms and so forth and so on.
The once small and vulnerable outpost would now become a vast lunar city and the new Shadow headquarters, with many episodes focusing on the latest alien plot to destroy the base.
It's going to come. I want to be ready.
Anderson's UFO 2 team began to form, with art directors Bob Bell and Keith Wilson designing the interiors of the new moon base, and Brian Johnson the exteriors. With a third season of The Protectors also looking very likely, and Tony Barwick already committed to that show, Christopher Penfold was hired to be the new script editor.
I'll pass it along to the script department.
Ed Bishop was also very excited at the chance to return to the role of Commander Straker, and no doubt several other members of the UFO cast were also under consideration for the new series.
Here we go again.
But unfortunately, in early 1973, the project was to grind to an unexpected halt.
The ratings started to drop in America.
The conclusion of All in the Family's current run on CBS had coincided with the end of first-run UFO episodes in syndication, and while repeats of both shows continued in the same time slots, their ratings obviously began to decline.
And what?
Rather than investigate the source of this drop, ITC in New York began to lose confidence in the idea of a second season of UFO entirely and pulled the plug on the project.
Stop it! Stop it! Stop it!
Everything was going to be better, and we were poised for that, and to not be able to realize it was a deep, deep disappointment. It took me a long time to get over that.
By this time, a substantial amount of money had been poured into preparing for the second season, and Anderson was determined that that money would not be wasted.
I went to see Lou and I said, look, we've done a lot of work and I reckon that I could twist this around and make it into another science fiction show. And he said, fine, let's do it.
However, as had often been the case during production of UFO, this new series was to be subject to certain conditions imposed by ITC America. The first of these was in response to the UFO episodes that had explored the personal costs that Commander Straker had had to pay in order to keep the Shadow Organization functioning. A great hit with fans, but apparently not so much with the executives.
Oh no.
So we started work on the new show, and then I got a call from Abe Mandel.
Abe Mandel, who would continue to be a thorn in Anderson's side for the next few years, was particularly insistent that the format of the new series would make it absolutely impossible to shoot any scenes on Earth, in order to avoid, as he described it, people having tea in the Midlands.
Would you care for some more coffee?
And he said to me, Gerry, I don't want any shows on Earth. I want you to do something to the show that will make it impossible for you to shoot a show on Earth.
Surprised by this reaction to episodes that they felt were among UFO's strongest, the Andersons' original proposed solution was to destroy the Earth entirely.
It's that old bloody-mindedness.
And when this was declared too grim for a family show,
we blew the moon out of orbit with everybody on it. And I rang Abe and said, is this okay? And he said, yeah, fine.
Much better.
Gerry and Sylvia then set to work writing a 30-minute pilot script named Zero G for the new show, the working title of which was Menace from Space.
But it is not ideal.
Zero G told the story of the inhabitants of Moon City, manned by operatives of the organization WANDA, the World Association of Nations Defending Earth Rights.
I've got a nasty feeling we're being watched.
With an alien spaceship constantly observing the base, Commander Steve Maddox is currently overseeing an unmanned space probe to be sent to investigate their planet. And so, afraid that this is the first step in humanity's attempted conquest, the aliens would alter the moon's gravitation to send it spinning off into the unknown void of space.
Can we make it back to Earth?
Many of the familiar elements of what would ultimately become the first episode of Space 1999 are present in the script for Zero G.
Not Steve Maddox.
Although the character names of Steve Maddox, Dr. Gordon, Mark Miller, and Lieutenant Caron did not survive to the series, the lead roles of Base Commander, Chief Medical Officer, Science Officer, and Head of the Reconnaissance Section were firmly established in the Anderson script, as was their primary mode of transportation, the MTU, or Multiple Transport Unit.
I was thumbing through some nature magazines and I saw the head of this grasshopper and, well, because if you look at all aircraft, all rockets, they look basically like insects of one form or another. And so it all happened from there, really.
Several sources over the years have indicated that the earliest versions of the script even retained familiar UFO elements, including the Shadow Interceptors and Moonmobiles, SID, and possibly even the same aliens. But all were eventually dropped as the focus of the story moved from alien intervention to humanity's own short-sightedness.
When will they ever learn?
With a basic premise and draft script completed, many new titles were considered and rejected, before finally, in March 1973, the new series was first announced to the press as Space 1999.
Space 1999. It's going to be a very good year.
The series was to be co-financed by RAI, the state broadcaster of Italy, who were at the same time co-financing another ITC venture, the miniseries Moses the Lawgiver, starring Burt Lancaster. Unlike Moses, the nature of Space 1999's story prohibited any filming in Italy, but the co-production deal with RAI stipulated that Italian actors must also be seen in guest roles over the course of the series.
There is a purpose.
And so two Italian characters were created to join the regular cast: head of reconnaissance Captain Alfonso Catani and data analyst Sandra Sabatini. However, it had already been decided that the two lead characters would be American.
Dr. Helena Russell and yourself, Commander John Cherney.
The casting of these roles would be crucial if the series was going to be sold to a major American network. And in August 1973, Gerry and Sylvia Anderson headed to Los Angeles, where they met with their first choice for the role of Commander Koenig, actor Robert Culp.
Commander?
Although Sylvia Anderson was in favor of Culp, her husband Gerry and ITC president Abe Mandel were alarmed by his demands to also write and direct episodes, and negotiations were swiftly terminated. Their meeting with Martin Landau and Barbara Bain went much more smoothly, with the two actors being very excited by the show's premise and possibilities.
Come with us to Moonbase Alpha.
When the president of CBS, Robert Wood, agreed to buy the series if the pair were cast in the lead roles, it looked like an Anderson series might finally be sold to an American network for the first time since Fireball XL5 over a decade ago.
What's going to stop us?
I just felt there was going to be the next thing, and I also felt that it was a great platform for saying things. Some of the Space 1999s are very politically grounded in terms of some of the things that were going on in the world were reflected in that in a very subtle way at the time.
You must remain neutral.
I would love to remain neutral, but my idea of neutrality is not being a sitting duck and being shot at by both sides.
You couldn't do that in the streets of San Francisco. Now, this is 2 years before Star Wars. There was no science fiction virtually. Star Trek, at that point, had been a failure. It was a couple of years later that the whole kind of phenomenon started with Star Trek in America.
I guess we weren't sufficiently entertaining.
I just felt it was time that was the next thing. So that kind of stuff, you know, and it sort of coagulated.
Gerry and Sylvia Anderson had come over to the States to see Martin and I about doing it. We didn't know any of them. They arrived at our doorstep one day, and it was August of 1973, and they presented the concept to us, and they had a lot of sketches and a lot of story outlines and a fantastic amount of enthusiasm. And we started talking, and the more we talked, the more excited we all got about it. The whole concept of the show was appealing to us, everything about it.
Also recruited during this trip was George Belak, a prolific television writer who would pen the first episode, and with whom Martin Landau had previously worked on Broadway. Another important meeting took place in California, this time between the Andersons and the world-renowned Austrian fashion designer Rudi Gernreich, which was easily arranged thanks to Gernreich's friendship with Barbara Bain. Gernreich's name added further prestige to the production, and he would receive on-screen credit for the design of the costumes near the beginning of every episode.
Aren't we doing well?
The choice of director for the first episode was once again of paramount importance for the Americans, and Barbara Bain suggested Lee H. Katzin, with whom she and her husband had worked previously on Mission Impossible. Having helmed many American television pilots, Katzin seemed a safe pair of hands to get the new series up and running.
Oh, it's Fort Myersmore.
Back in England, Lou Grade offered the as-yet-unnamed character of the Professor to actor Barry Morse.
Hello.
Having recently spent much time filming abroad, including lead roles in the ITC action shows The Zoo Gang and The Adventurer, Morse was keen to commit to a project shooting much closer to home, although was startled when Grade told him that there were no completed scripts he could take a look at.
It's extraordinary.
The casting of Landau and Bain, however, enticed him to accept the project, although he remained frustrated by the lack of attention to the show's characters throughout the course of its production.
I just hope it's interesting.
Instead, he devised a backstory of his own for the professor, beginning with the premise that the young Victor Bergman was a refugee from Austria during the Second World War. Morse continued to flesh out the bare bones of the character's outline in his own mind throughout the course of production, and the result would ultimately be one of the show's most popular and beloved characters. Meanwhile, the show's regular models and sets were also being designed and constructed.
We assume that these people are in a controlled environment. They wouldn't have a great deal of resources. So the idea was to make it as simple, as clean, as clinical as possible, and as easy to wear as it possibly would be if you were living in a city on the moon. Now, no way would I have time or room to keep on building different sets every week. So I spoke to the producer, Gerry Anderson, and we had the idea of making a modular system. So it's like a big jigsaw puzzle or a Lego set. Every week, I could change all the sets very quickly.
In late August, George Bellak arrived at Elstree Studios and quickly formed a good working relationship with Christopher Penfold. Together, they set to work fleshing out the Andersons' initial concept, and on September 3rd turned in a writer's guide for the series that explored the world of Moonbase Alpha in more detail.
Yeah, have a look.
It was here that many more familiar elements of the series began to take shape, including the various sections that the Moonbase Alpha staff worked in, as indicated by their coloured uniform sleeves, as well as their weapons, communication devices, and medical monitors. The guide also included brief biographies of the main characters of Commander John Koenig, Dr. Helena Russell, and the still-to-be-named Professor.
Some landmark.
With the format for the series now firmly established, Bellak got to work on his script for the first episode, now to be titled The Void Ahead. By the time this was completed, however, the relationship between Bellak and Anderson had grown decidedly frosty, with Anderson expecting an absolute commitment to Space 1999 that conflicted with Bellak's other writing engagements.
Well, that's completely out of the question.
Bellak soon departed the series, but enjoyed a close friendship with Christopher Penfold over the subsequent decades until Bellak's death in 2002.
Things are far more serious than I suspect you've been told.
In October, the first major disaster befell the production's base at EMI MGM Elstree Studios when MGM pulled out of their collaboration with EMI and the studio faced potential closure.
You cannot stay here.
The situation was all too familiar to the Andersons, as the previous closure of the MGM Borehamwood studio had interrupted production on UFO for 9 months, until the series could find a new home at Pinewood Studios.
So, what are we going to do about it?
With the Landaus due to arrive in England before the end of the month, Gerry and Sylvia were extremely reluctant to risk shooting at Elstree, and instead made the drastic decision to relocate the entire production to Pinewood before the new series could get underway. Over the course of a weekend, the show's sets were dismantled and moved to Pinewood in secret.
It's good to believe in, Commander.
The standing main mission set was established on Stage L, while Stage M would be used for episode-specific sets.
Oh, we must at least go on with the preparations.
This unorthodox and unpublicized solution to the problem resulted in Space 1999 being blacklisted by the unions.
Well, I suppose that's an understandable reaction.
But it did allow the series to enter production on time and relatively unaffected by the problems at Elstree.
Well, it seems all right.
So far.
Soon after, another major setback occurred when CBS abruptly cancelled their order for Space 1999 in favour of a new science fiction series of their own. Having just enjoyed a massive rating success with the US television premiere of the 1968 film Planet of the Apes, the network had decided to produce a spin-off television series, and Space 1999, being produced on the other side of the world, was no longer of interest to them.
Why? How could they do it?
They're animals.
No other networks were willing to take the series either.
God damn
but by now it was too late to prevent Space 1999 from entering production.
I refuse to believe we have no future.
Despite these setbacks, the script for the first episode was now entering its final form. On November 5th, the title changed from The Void Ahead to Turning Point.
Turning Point, right?
Although George Belak is still credited as the sole writer on the finished episode, the shooting script had been almost entirely rewritten by Christopher Penfold, although it still largely followed the basic outline of Belak's original story.
So far.
On November 5th, the visual effects team under the command of Brian Johnson began shooting the episode's model shots and special effects sequences at Bray Studios in Buckinghamshire, only to run into another major problem.
What is it?
For the next 6 weeks, every shot they filmed was rendered unusable by a fluctuating exposure.
This instrument's given me a lead.
The problem was eventually traced to a dragging break on a film magazine, but only after hours of testing and experimentation, and a loss of thousands of pounds.
The giant leap for mankind. It's beginning to look like a stumble in the dark.
Meanwhile, other regular roles were being cast. Thanks to having recently worked with the Andersons in the Protector's two-parter Wham, Prentice Hancock was cast as main mission controller Paul Morrow, originally devised as a Russian named Verkonnen.
Medical section, Paul.
The Japanese Dr. Fujita became Dr. Matthias, after casting director Michael Barnes spotted Anton Phillips performing in a play at the King's Head Pub in Islington.
Obviously.
For computer specialist Benjamin Umer, Barnes selected an American actor and singer named Lon Satton, who had most recently appeared in Roger Moore's first James Bond film, Live and Let Die.
Yes, sir.
For the minor role of Eagle Pilot Collins, Barnes cast an eager Australian actor by the name of Nick Tate.
Collins? Check, Commander.
However, Tate had his sights set a little higher than just a couple of scenes, and insisted on a meeting with the Andersons and director Katzin.
I don't think we should wait for them to make the next move.
His persistence finally paid off when the Italian actor cast as Chief Eagle Pilot Alfonso Catani had to depart the production due to a prior filming commitment in Italy. Tate was then tested for the role, playing a variety of nationalities before suggesting that his own natural Australian accent was perfectly acceptable.
Come on, let's cut the talking and get going.
Ever aware of the all-important American audience, the Andersons made the mistake of observing that an Australian accent might sound like Cockney to stateside viewers.
You gotta be joking.
After firmly setting them straight about that, Tate signed a contract to appear in the first 6 episodes of the series, and Alfonso Catani became Alan Carter.
Now you're talking.
The show's other Italian character, Sandra Sabatini, was proving even harder to cast.
Sandra! Sandra!
After 2 trips to Rome in search of suitable actresses proved unsuccessful, the solution was finally found back in London in the shape of Borneo-born actress Xenia Merton.
I will be waiting.
Suzanne Roquette was cast in the recurring role of German main mission operative Tanya Alexander.
Tanya Alexander.
Hello, Tanya.
Security.
While Tony Allen and Quentin Pierre made their first appearances as recurring security guards Tony Allen and Pierce Quinton. Additionally, Sylvia Anderson selected a group of background artists who became familiar faces in main mission over the course of the series, several of whom she had previously employed on UFO.
You're ready to go.
Yeah. We're ready to go.
The cast spent the last 2 weeks of November reporting for various costume fittings, film tests, and rehearsals at Pinewood Studios. And on November 22nd, the script was retitled one last time from Turning Point to Breakaway.
Just what we're looking for, isn't it?
At long last, live-action filming for Space 1999 began on Monday, December 3rd, 1973, on M Stage at Pinewood Studios.
Day to remember.
But if the cast and crew thought it would all be smooth sailing from here, they were to be sorely disappointed, as Breakaway would go on to be one of the most troubled productions of any Anderson series, but that's another story.
Now we're sitting on the biggest bomb man's ever made.
Is this the end or the beginning?
What do you make of it, Victor?
Some sort of creative evolution. A stage in its development. Perhaps the beginnings. Birth.
While Gerry Anderson fans will always debate the merits of UFO versus Space 1999, the story of how one became the other demonstrates how dependent all his television productions of that era were on achieving success in America, and how an odd sequence of events brought one of them back to life before transforming it into something else entirely.
That's how Space 1999 came about.
Let's do this. It's exciting. We, you know, lived in London for several years, and it was a good change, creatively, personally, in every way.
We did our best to make the show as interesting and an artistic achievement, but it wasn't kicked off that way.
More importantly, though, it serves as yet another example of the Andersons and those around them overcoming adversity and aiming for the stars, and in this case, literally.
Yes. Maybe there.
UFO 2 2?
Hey?
UFO 2 2? So obviously you know right. The original series of UFO 2 became Space 1999, right?
Yes.
Mm-hmm. Well, there was potentially going to be a UFO 2 2 in the 1990s.
Right. So okay.
In 1996, Australian fan Albert Hastings was inspired to create a follow-up to the original UFO, which was going to be entitled UFO 2.
Right. Okay.
I mean, it makes sense, doesn't it?
It's a little bit rude, isn't it? But anyway, carry on.
Is it?
Well, no, go on.
I see what you're saying there, but No, Richard, get that mind out the gutter.
Yeah, sorry.
No, Albert's idea was to continue the original story, starring Major General Straker, Brigadier General Alec Freeman. You see, they've all been sent up the ranks.
Very good.
And those two now commanded a greatly expanded shadow organisation. And it even forged alliances with two other alien races to protect the Earth from a variety of other aliens.
Ah.
Yes. So it's not just the organ-harvesting originals in the red suits with the green liquid-containing helmets, but other aliens to be involved as well. Now, I vaguely remember Albert approaching Dad, sending him a letter, I think, with the treatment in, saying, here's what I'm trying to bring together. Would you be okay if I tried to get it off the ground? And I'm pretty sure Dad said, I mean, give it a go. Yeah, absolutely. If it happened, then fantastic. So he got blessing from Dad and Ed Bishop as well.
Right.
But unfortunately, the project fell apart, as these things often do, because if you're going to try and build this world of massive shadow organization, all the kind of UFOs, different alien races, all that kind of stuff, it became very, very expensive.